Hello, and welcome to Forget What You Learned, a place for families to stop and reflect on the modern state of education. We empower you to challenge your own thinking about today's traditional school system and ask the question, are my kids thriving? I'm Corey Greenberg, a parent in the trenches just like you, and I chat with innovators, experts, and other parents who are changing the conversation, inspiring families to reevaluate how we define academic success. This podcast is brought to you by Pacific Preparatory and TutorCore, sister organizations molding education through innovative one-on-one learning for students in today's digital world. In today's episode, producer Mel joins us for a conversation with Iris Chen, an author and founder of what she calls the Untigering Movement, which aims to inspire generational and cultural transformation, especially among Asian communities. Iris is also an unschooling mom, which means she allows her children educational freedom, something a lot of families might not understand. I told her I thought it was a radical idea, but as Mel embarks on her own unschooling journey with her kids, she and Iris unpack what it actually means and what it doesn't, which is an image of kids choosing to play video games all day. Iris talks about her own background, being raised with authoritarian parents, intensely focused on outward measures of success, and what inspired her to do things differently with her own kids. While unschooling may not be for every family, there are some really important takeaways that all parents should hear. Well, hello. Today's episode is so exciting because we have producer Mel Nichols joining us for a thought-provoking, kind of radical conversation with our guest today, Iris Chen. Iris describes herself as an author, unschooling mom, deconstructing tiger parent, and founder of the Untigering Movement. As an advocate for peaceful parenting and educational freedom for children, her mission is to inspire generational and cultural transformation, especially among Asian communities. She spent 16 years living overseas in China, but now resides in her native California with her husband and two sons. Mel came across Iris on Instagram, where Iris shares her mission with north of 70,000 followers on the platform. Our producer, Mel, was a middle school teacher before transitioning into the one-to-one education space 8 years ago, and is now beginning an unschooling journey in her own family. So Iris's message resonates deeply over in our corner of the world. What struck us both about Iris is her unique perspective, both on parenting and our modern traditional education system, which underwent a seismic transformation in her own family life. We're gonna dive in first to her personal story to explain how she came to found the Untigering Movement, which may be a term our listeners have never heard before. Welcome to the podcast, Iris and Mel.
Thank you for having me, Corey.
So happy to have you both here, and I really can't wait to dive in. So, Iris, can you just start us off by telling us a little bit about your own background and journey, and kind of what you're doing now? How did you get here?
Yeah, so I started, like you described, I started out as a tiger parent. And for those of you who don't know what that means, that's from Amy Chua's book, The Battle Hymn of the Tiger Mother. And she describes her own Chinese upbringing as well as the way she was parenting her two daughters at the time. Quote unquote Chinese parenting, which she equated with tiger parenting. And it's just the style of parenting that is authoritarian, very demanding, high expectations towards the children, has the goal of raising high achieving, obedient, successful children. And so I think when I was growing up, I didn't have that term. Like, that book hadn't come out yet, and I wouldn't have called my parents tiger parents. But I think among many Asian immigrant communities, that type of parenting was normalized. It was very authoritarian, very strict, a lot of rules, you know, none of, like, among my Asian American friends, we were not allowed to date, we were not allowed to go out on school nights, you know, all of that. And so when I had my own children, I was like, okay, I'm gonna loosen up. I'm not gonna be as strict as my parents. And yet there was still this expectation of absolute obedience and of excelling, you know, in whatever you put your mind to. And so I was still parenting in that very authoritarian way, still, you know, incorporating warmth and love and affection and things like that, but also a lot of behavior management and control. And it wasn't, and yeah, like it wasn't working. Like I feel like in my generation, at least for me, it really quote unquote worked on me because I became a compliant child. I became like the good girl who learned how to follow all the rules, who did everything I was expected to do, didn't question, didn't talk back, didn't push back in any way. And so I expected my children to be the same. And they weren't. They weren't at all. They pushed back a lot, and especially my oldest child, I just had so many power struggles and conflict with him. And I was so frustrated, but I thought, as a good parent, my responsibility is to manage his behavior. And so I came down with harder punishments, more control, more anger, and it just kept on escalating and escalating. And it wasn't until I sort of like hit rock bottom with that and realized that this was not working, that I realized I needed to find another way. Started learning from like going to parenting workshops and reading books and really exposed to another way of seeing my children that wasn't based on behavior management. It was really understanding neurobiology so that I could have realistic expectations of my children, understanding their need for attachment and co-regulation and all of those things. It was really mind-blowing for me because I hadn't been modeled or taught that way of parenting. Everything that I had read or that was modeled to me was a very authoritarian behavior management type of parenting. And so, yeah, I began my own personal journey of untigering, like deconstructing all of that learning and conditioning that I had grown up with.
Can I just say the level of self-awareness that it takes for you to have that rock bottom moment, like you said, and then to seek out, the help and the resources to do it differently? I mean, I think there's a lot of parents out there that are in that situation where they don't know where to turn, but they do realize things aren't working. And it's interesting, like, your story about you were the way your parents were, and then, you just became what they wanted. I see that that is changing in this generation of kids. Like, there's a lot of people in our generation who did that. Their parents parented a certain way and they just kind of followed along. But the way we raise kids now, even within the traditional education system, like, this generation of kids is bucking that system. They're just not with the program.
Yeah, I think it's like this change in collective consciousness where children themselves recognize that they do have power, they do have dignity, they do have agency, and so they're not going to just submit to us just because. And our generation and our parents' generation were probably like that. It's just like, okay, in order to survive, in order to function in this society and in this family, I just have to obey and do as I'm told. And I think our children are now in an environment, and hopefully we're also raising them to be people who know who they are, who can speak up for themselves. But that's a painful process for us as parents to learn how to just interact in that way, because again, it wasn't modeled. So we still have those expectations. Like, yes, I want you to be confident and I want you to be a leader, but I still want you to do everything I tell you to do. And so a lot of it has to do with adjusting our own expectations.
Yeah, absolutely. And like you said, I think that's a long process that I know you talk about, just giving yourself grace and trying to let go of any of the shame that you felt about mistakes that you make. I mean, I think parents, me included, you know, we get bogged down in the things that we did wrong. And we forget that, first of all, kids are very resilient. And secondly, that they want us to be human too. And to, like, admitting to them when we make a mistake and having them be part of the conversation of moving forward is a really valuable experience for them.
Yeah, absolutely. So instead of seeing ourselves as parents as needing to have it all together, as having all the answers, being the ones in control, like expecting perfection of ourselves, like how can we have a shared humanity in relationship with our children? And I think that's really valuable for our children.
So can you talk about, you know, this journey of parenting that you went on? How did school, your children's school and your perspective on school change within that journey?
Yeah, so my family, we unschool, which means we really are trying to live outside of the school system. And so we don't do tests, curriculum, homework, at least none of that I impose on them. Like if they choose to pursue, like take a Khan Academy class or something like that, an out-school class, they are free to do that, but it's nothing that I impose on them. And I think it really started out because of my parenting journey, as I was deconstructing all the ways that I was trying to control them, again, impose my own expectations and values upon them, really for perhaps like my own ego or in order like to have them fit in society in a way that felt safe or that felt familiar and comfortable. But I think the more I went down this peaceful parenting journey of really seeing my child as their own person, as like having their own interests, as like deserving of dignity and autonomy, all of those things, I really couldn't reconcile that with compulsory schooling. I couldn't imagine them going into a system that didn't value them as whole human beings and wanted to conform them in some sort of way. And it's funny because when I think back on my schooling experience, I was good at school. I loved school. I really enjoyed school in a lot of ways because I excelled in school. Mm-hmm. But like looking, you know, in hindsight, I see all the ways that school really wounded me as well, where I learned to people please. I learned how to follow everybody else's desire, but I had no connection to my own desires, my own interests, my own needs. And so people say like, okay, unschooling is a great option for those who cannot thrive in school. But for me, as somebody who did thrive in school, I say school is, I don't know, like, it's not a great option for anybody in an ideal world. Because even for those who do well in school, it reinforces a lot of just values and patterns that we don't want to continue as adults. And now as adults, if we look at a lot of the mental health issues or like the healing, the inner child healing that we have to do, a lot of that is like the de-schooling of these patterns that we learned through systems, not only through school, you know, like through authoritarian parenting, through society in general. A lot of it is undoing those things that we had to learn. And so I think unschooling is really a beautiful option for anybody, not just those who don't do well in a traditional school system.
I think it's good to put out there, Iris, that what you said is very radical, and I love it. But it truly is very radical because it just goes against what I think so many people in this country are just doing what is expected. I mean, just like we've already talked about, but the idea of undoing everything that they've like thought was going to be the normal path for their kids is anxiety producing. Like I'm just thinking myself, like, okay, I actually agree with what you're saying, but the thought of pulling all three of the kids out of their traditional school and then being responsible for what happens next is kind of scary. I'm being honest, it's scary.
Yes, it is. And I feel that. And I think that's like more of the what we call in our world de-schooling that we have to do, where we feel like parents have to be responsible for our child's learning, because the reality is that learning is very natural. Like, we don't have to force it to happen. That's just human nature. To learn, to observe the world around us, to take in information, to absorb the things that are relevant to our lives, problem solve, experiment. We're doing like scientific experiments in our minds all the time. You look at little babies, you don't have to sit them in a classroom and they learn how to absorb language, how to climb, how to walk. And so I think again, trusting in the innate curiosity and drive to learn. The problem is that we have a schoolish mindset where we believe that unless somebody forces a child to learn, they will not learn. And so it's a really warped way of thinking about something that is natural. We have taken something that is natural and made it very systematic and compulsory. The minute you make something forced and you demand it, you take all the joy and the organic nature of it out of it, then of course children are going to resist. We would resist. We as adults resist against that type of learning. So I think tapping back into the trust in a child's innate nature to learn can really free us as the parent to not feel such a burden on our shoulders to like, oh my goodness, I need to do math and I need to do like all these subjects to make sure that they are getting the type of quality education that they need. Again, there's so many things to unpack about what learning actually is, what education actually is, and to think outside the box of traditional school, because in life, a lot of the things that we learn in school are not really relevant. If you think about all of the things, all of the years, the hours that we spent doing things in school, how much of it do we actually use in our daily lives? And I think that's a question that we need to ask ourselves. Like, are we just jumping through the hoops because that's the way things have always been done? Or do these things actually have value? And I think going back to, even though it feels really radical, and I totally feel that, but the modern education system is actually very young, if you think about it. Like, it's only existed for couple hundred years. I don't even know the exact numbers, but how did people and children survive and learn for millennia before that, right? So is it that radical, or is it a coming back, a returning to our true nature and true childhood and creating space for children to be children during that time?
I know that I read, when you read about unschooling, something that unschoolers like to say is, the experiment is actually standard schooling as we traditional schooling as we see it today, because, it is so relatively new. Of course, our parents and our parents' parents went to school, but before that, it was different.
Yeah. So we think that it's the way that things have always been, but it's not. And if you do some research about the history of the schooling system that we are currently into and the values, it's really was not there to it wasn't built for children. It was really built for adults who needed to go to work, and we needed to find a place to put all a bunch of children so they wouldn't get in trouble. And so it doesn't value the child. It's not like, I know that a lot of teachers go through early childhood education and understand all these things about early childhood. But when it comes to the reality of like teaching in a system, they realize that it's totally, it doesn't even fit the things that they've learned about what early childhood should really be like. And so I think, again, that's something that we need to question. What is the experiment? Is it not putting kids in school, or is it putting kids in school?
Well, and your comment a few minutes ago about kids, you know, the learning is not all that relevant. I mean, that I was laughing on the inside, because ask a 13-year-old, you know, if they want to do the assignments that their history teacher assigns, when they think like, I'm never going to need to know all of these dates, or this, you know, advanced math that they know they're never going to use this. And the, you know, kids are, it's like out of the mouth of babes, because they will tell you, I'm never going to use this. Why do I have to learn it? You know?
Exactly. And I think like, it takes a while for systems to change. So a lot of the things that are being taught now, like, you know, were put into the curriculum 50 years ago, 20 years ago. And by the time our children graduate, the world's going to be a completely different place.
Right.
And so, like, I think what's more important than the content of what we are teaching our children is to teach them the skills to learn, teach them how to learn. And we don't actually need to teach them too much, because they will experiment and find the ways that they learn best. You know, even the ways that we teach them might not be the best for them, but like, give them access to different tools. There's the internet, there's the library, there's other adults. There's just so many resources available at our tips now. And so, forcing them to memorize some dates, or even to do math, like simple math when you have a calculator right in front of you, or like just all these skills that we think are necessary, I think we need to question those again. You know, like cursive handwriting, is that absolutely necessary in this coming day and age? A lot of these skills that we have been ingrained in us as being compulsory is like basic building blocks. I mean, I think we need to really rethink that a lot now with all the tools that we have at our fingertips.
Yeah, one of the things like we've talked about in this podcast before is kind of what you said about the system hasn't caught up to what we need from our grown adults, you know, in the working world at all. And so, you know, we have this factory-based model system, but we want to raise Google employees who are thinking outside the box and creatively and, you know, able to work as a team and project-based, all of that. And it's just, they're not matched up together. And it does leave kids behind in terms of their emotional needs. One story that I would love for you to share, because I thought it was just amazing, was this blog post you wrote about your 13-year-old and a fitness test.
Yes.
And I'll let you tell the listeners what it was, because I think it's a perfect example of how you're doing things differently and what that outcome, so to speak, is.
Yeah. So we are unschoolers, but we also do it through a charter school. And so to be a part of the charter school, my 13-year-old had to do a physical fitness test. All eighth graders have to do a physical fitness test. He wasn't that excited about it. He had never taken like a PE class, had never really done sit-ups in his life, or a pull-up, or any of that stuff. I was saying, like, that's just not how kids move. Like, why would a kid voluntarily just move in that way? Those are exercises that adults make children do to assess their fitness, like how many sit-ups can you do? But that's not necessarily a way that a child would naturally move. So anyways, we went to the fitness test, And I know that I had a lot of anxiety watching him as he was like barely doing two sit-ups or whatever, because I remember being in those environments where everybody was watching. You would either get judged or laughed at for not being able to perform certain tasks. But he was just, unfazed by it all. And even for the mile run, like other kids were, running at full speed the first few laps, and he was just like moseying along the entire time. Like, oh, like I don't really care about this. What my time is, like, who's going to look at this anyway? And yeah, so the whole thing really ex just brought to light for me my own fears and my own anxieties that I needed to work through as a parent, watching my child be assessed in this way, versus his reaction, where he's been unschooled most of his life. So it's just like, and we have told him multiple times, these tests don't mean anything. Assessments don't mean anything. You don't have to worry about them. You don't have to worry about the results. So he really didn't worry about the results. And because this was not a priority for him, like he didn't need to prove his fitness to anybody. And so he was just like, I'm just going to do this in a way that feels good for me. So he was like jumping on the logs. He was just having a good old time with it instead of actually running like everybody wanted him to run. And so I think I saw how when a child can resist some of that outward gaze, that assessment, and being worried about how others perceive them, then they can be free to just show up in whatever way feels right and best for them. And I think is a really freeing way to engage in some of those things that are required of us sometimes when that we don't want to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just think like it must have been kind of profound for you to be watching him have that experience. And it was different from your own childhood. Like you said that, kind of having that people-pleasing nature. Like if you were doing that, you probably would have been trying your hardest and doing all the things, even though like it wasn't something you wanted to do. But then watching your son, who you've raised in this way, just kind of be himself, like that must have felt really good to you.
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't feeling good. I had a lot of anxiety about it. But afterwards, I was like, really reflecting on why did I feel so anxious? And why was I was actually really triggered by the whole experience, because it's like, I'm feeling a lot of anxiety. And I wanted to go and intervene and like tell him, come on, put in some effort. But he just wasn't. And so it was like holding up a mirror to myself and actually seeing like, oh, I have stuff that I need to work through about why I have such a hard time with the way he's showing up in this moment. But also really celebrating and being inspired by how he didn't really give, he didn't care. And yeah, that was really inspiring and freeing for me too.
And it's nice to look back and sort of, it's a mirror to yourself, but also what you're trying to do with unschooling, which is to say, come be who you are. And he's like, he's doing that,
Yes.
which is really cool.
Yes. Yeah.
So one misconception that I know a lot of people have about unschooling is that it just means, it's laissez-faire, there's no structure. Parents will say like, oh yeah, my kid would just play video games all day. And for the last 150, 200 years or so, society has told us, kids need to be in school during the day. So what do you say to parents who have those sorts of concerns?
Yeah, it's similar to what people say with peaceful parenting sometimes. It's just like, oh, well, that means you just let your child do whatever they want. And it's not, it's, I think because we have so few models of actually respectful, equitable relationships that we don't know what that looks like. And so we think it's either you're super controlling and super just telling your child what to do, or it's the other extreme and you're completely hands off. And it doesn't have to be that way. I think, again, it's really connection relationship based. That's essentially what unschooling is. It's about being in relationship with your child. So depending on what your child needs and wants, you provide what they want. If they want more structure, if they want you to teach them a certain subject, of course you are there for them. If they want you to back off and they want to be more independent, then so it's this dance again. It's understanding who your child is, what supports they need, and providing it for them to reach the goals that they have, instead of us, again, imposing our goals for them, our expectations, our standards, really giving them time and space to discover for themselves, who are you? Who do you want to be? What are your interests? What are your passions? What are the ways that you learn best? And then coming along and supporting them. So if that means like, and also like an age appropriate thing too, right? Like, if a child needs more structure, they'll ask for it. And then you can work together to provide a loose routine that works for you. It's not just like you're on your own. And there's others who might not want that and who want a lot more freedom. And so there's a conversation with that back and forth. I think also like the whole point about spending all day playing video games. I think video games get a really bad rap. There's a lot of fear around screens. And like for my children, they're 15 and 13 and they do spend a lot of time on the screens. As do I, because of the work that I do. And so it's not necessarily screens themselves, but how screens are being used, what they're doing on screens. And I think, again, de-schooling our ideas about screens or about video games even, where we think certain things are quote unquote educational and other things are non-educational, our leisure, are for fun, and therefore have less value. I think an unschooling mindset, again, like tears down all of those labels and all of those like silos about what is educational, what isn't, what is math, and what is English, and what is science, and all of those things. It's just like life is learning. All of it is relevant. We are whole people. So sleep is learning, eating is learning, relationships are learning, going outside to play is learning, playing video games is learning. I don't have to label certain things as educational and other things as not. It is all life. And I think when we're able to see life in that way, see learning in that way, there's a lot less anxiety about them spending so much time doing this one thing that I don't find value in, that I don't see as learning, but becoming more curious. It's like, oh, what are they getting out of this? What are the things that they're absorbing through this activity that they are obviously really excited about?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. And I think that's a good, it just like kind of points to, we, you know, when the gut reaction is, oh, but they'll play video games all day, instead of being curious about why they might do that or what they might get from that, or maybe they'll do that for a while and then go on to something else, but it might take a little bit of time. I think that as parents, we get into this like point where we're maybe acting out of fear or anxiety that we're hearing from, you know, in ourselves, from how we grew up, from a culture that says, you know, if you, if I don't do it this way, then this bad thing will happen. And so if I don't put my kids in school, then they won't know how to do anything. They won't be social. They won't, you know, all these things. And I think your point of saying, but how about turn it around and be curious? And how about what are the good things about this, instead of kind of acting from fear and anxiety, is a good, it's a good reflection for us to have.
Yeah. And I think just because we've talked about, you know, how, you know, quote unquote, radical this type of thinking is, I think for parents not to feel the pressure, again, this binary of I either put my kids in school or I have to unschool. I think, again, that's like not what we're talking about. I think we really need to be reflective and go inwards and like, what am I ready for at this moment in time? So that might mean that just means I cut back on too many extracurricular activities. That's the way I'm going to begin deschooling, or I'm not going to emphasize grades, or I'm going to give my child a mental health day, or I'm going to homeschool, but I'm going to have some curriculum. You know, I think all of that is fine. It's not about like needing to like suddenly throw yourself in the deep end, especially if you still have a lot of fears and a lot of things that you're not ready for. I think if you jump in before you're ready, before you have those tools and before you have those mindset shifts, then you're going to sink and it's not sustainable. Then you'll like things will not work out, and then you'll throw in the towel and say, this didn't work. So just encouraging parents, you know, you don't need to like jump in fully and say like, okay, this makes sense, I'm going to totally unschool. Just take baby steps, take the steps you need to test the waters. That's totally fine. And to see what feels right for you and your family, and continue to play with it, continue to experiment with it and see what works for your family.
I absolutely love that you said that, because there's so many things internally going on in my mind while I'm listening to you talk. And one of them is that to have, you know, a seismic mind frame shift, you really need to, number one, like take a leap of faith into saying like, oh, there's another way out there, and I'm gonna, you know, let go of some of those fears and anxieties, like Mel said, to just explore what it is and if it fits. And then the second thing is to find a community. So like when you're talking, you know, what you're talking about, Iris, part of the reason we have this podcast is to inspire parents to just test the waters and see what else is out there and if it fits, and then to go find a community that's gonna help support your new way of thinking. So as we sort of like wrap up here, what I would love to hear, and we're going to do the lightning round, okay, we will not forget that, but I want to know, you know, what can you tell us, like how parents can find you, and especially like how can they start to develop their own community around people who might be thinking a little bit differently and want to talk, have more conversations with other people in the same boat?
Yeah. Well, when I first started unschooling, I was in China. And so like having online community was a lifesaver, because I didn't know anybody around me that was doing anything like this. So one resource that I found was Alliance for Self-Directed Education. I believe it's self-directed.org. It also has a directory of other communities and learning centers and things like that of people who are on this unschooling self-directed journey as well. There's another community called My Reflection Matters that centers BIPOC perspectives in this work. And so there are a lot of resources. I think if you're wanting to look for a local community that's like in person, probably just on Facebook, looking up unschooling and then your city or your area. And in all likelihood, there will be something that will pop up and you can find a little community of people. And also, like for me, just connecting even with other homeschoolers who might not be like full on unschoolers, but still had enough overlap in values that was like a good community for me, for my family to start with, you know. In terms of where to find me, you can find me on untigering.com, and I also have social media accounts on Instagram and Facebook at untigering, so you can find me there.
Wonderful. I think a lot of people are going to find you if they haven't already.
Yes.
Okay, let's do the lightning round, and we're going to make this like super lightning fast. So are you ready?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. All right. The first question is, what is your favorite education or parenting related book?
I would recommend Akilah S. Richards' Raising Free People. Which is about unschooling as liberation and healing work.
Got it. Okay. What do you do in your free time?
I have been working on a jigsaw puzzle and I have been watching the Junior British Baking Show. So reading puzzles, watching Netflix, watching shows, all of that. And also like playing games with my family.
Love it. Love a good game night.
Yes.
Okay. What's in one word, what do children in this world need more of?
I would say freedom.
I had a feeling you were going to say that word. What's your favorite, like, feel good song?
The one that came to mind is Sarah Bareilles' Brave.
Okay, love it. And lastly, if you could summon anything to your desk right now, what would it be?
I would summon a masseuse.
Ooh, that's a good one.
Yeah, that sounds nice.
Yes, yes, I could just sit here while they rub my shoulders.
I think Mel would like that too, actually.
Yeah, I love massages. I just come to my desk and shoulder massage.
Yes. Yep. Yes, yes, yes.
Well, Iris, this was just such a thought-provoking conversation as I knew that it would be. And we will put all of your information in the show notes for people to find you. And I just hope that the conversation was inspiring to other people. I think that you truly are changing the conversation around what we need to do with our kids in terms of parenting and their education. And it was such a treat to have producer Mel here with us today. Yes. And just thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you. I had a great time.
Thank you so much, Iris.
Yeah.
Take care, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
We hope you enjoyed this episode of Forget What You Learned, hosted by me, Corey Greenberg. As always, our goal is to allow you to zoom out on the snapshot of your family's life and answer the question, are my kids thriving? We're here to inspire you to make those small and maybe big changes to answer yes. We'd like to thank our sponsors, Pacific Preparatory and TutorCore, sister organizations committed to educating students with an innovative and holistic approach in today's digital world. Don't forget to subscribe to the show and leave a rating and review. See you next time.